of infinite dimensional space. So let me show you how these things happens, you know. So basically the cardinality of C is infinite. So they are introduced by Peter Elias in 1955. So using algebra and finite state machine. So finite state machine is a very important concept in computer science. We know that in computer science there are only four kind of machines. First one is finite state machine. Finite state automata means that every input you move to some state. So at you know after every input, okay. So that is a key concept is used for encoding and decoding here. You know. So let me introduce. And later on, a lot of work was done by Dave Forney. You know, in conventional codes. So here is an example of a conventional code. So basically, how it is generated. There is a picture here. You can see it's known as shift register. Okay. So how it is, how it encodes. On the left-hand side, you see the input is a vector x coming. So x1, x2, x3, x4, x0. Also x0, x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6. They are entering from left-hand side. And the middle, there are you know two memory things. You know, so there are two bits. You know, like we are here. You can see xi minus one and xi minus two. So there, the initial state is normally 0, 0. It's the shift register. And then it changes as the input comes. And input comes, you can assume the input is a stream of 0 and 1 entering into the system. Okay. So one input and two output. So two outputs are there, C1 and C2. How you can compute C1 and C2? C1i is nothing but at every time interval i, C1i is nothing but xi, x of i plus x of i minus 1 plus x of i minus 2. So whatever was there initial content here in the shift register plus xi, that value is C1i output, and C2i is xi plus xi minus 2. Okay, so this is how we do the encoding. So let me I will show you the encoding of 110101 using this shift register sequence. It's something very important. So here in this picture you can see that input is 1, so one input and two outputs are there. Okay, so always number of outputs are more than the number of inputs. Okay, so just like that, if k is the input and n is the output, so k is less than n. Okay, n is the number of outputs. Okay, so basically these codes were introduced in 1955, and later on sequential decoding algorithms were known in 1960s. They were used for spacecraft transmission. And in 1967, Andrew Witterbee, when teaching a course on coding theory, he was trying to teach the decoding methods, that he realized that decoding can be done in a much better way. And then he invented his decoding scheme, now known as Witterbee decoding, very popular, very famous decoding algorithm. So I'm going to explain to you how this is done. So now, in order to formulate mathematical concept of this, you know, so you know this picture we have seen here, how this shift register sequence works, right? So now I can formalize from I can formulate from here a algebraic concept. Okay, and now to do that, note that if xi is entering at one end, xi minus 1 and xi minus 2 are basically kind of, you can think of just like a delay. Okay, so there is a delay of one time interval, there's a delay of two time interval, you know, those portions are there. So you know that is what is written in these equations as well. So let me show you how this is done. So suppose input stream of bit entering is x0, x1, x2, x3, dot 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 xi, and if the size of the input stream is capital L, then I can associate a polynomial x is equal to summation I is equal to 0 to L minus 1 x of I d raised for I. D is a delay operation, as I told you, and this belongs to F2D. Set of all polynomials in variable D is known as F2D. It's our integral domain, just like set of integers is integral domain, right? And we know that set of integers we can form a field of rational numbers Q by considering P by Q, where Q is not equal to 0, and P and Q belongs to set of integers, right? In the same manner, we can define here F2 of D is a field is a rational field. P of d divided by Q of d, these two division of two polynomials, where P and Q belongs to F2D and Q of d is not equal to zero. So from the integral domains, right, I can find out this rational field. Now, NK convolutional code C is a k-dimensional subspace of F2D raised to power n. Okay, since cardinality of F2D is infinity, so this whole thing is infinity, right? It's a k-dimensional subspace of n-dimensional subspace, right? Over the infinite field, F2D is infinite field. So cardinality of C is infinite and rate of C is equal to k by n. So here a code word C is equal to C1, C2, Cn, which is nothing but, depending upon the input X, if you multiply with a matrix G, we get C. So G is a matrix Gij, which is a matrix of size k by n, where Gij is our entries in F2D. So any non-zero element of F2D, if you multiply in the generator matrix by any non-zero element of F2D, I will get another generator matrix. Let me show you a couple of examples. Here in this example, you see generator matrix is 1 plus D plus D square, 1 plus D square. Now you observe that this generator matrix is exactly, keeping this concept. So 1 is Xi. Plus d minus I minus 1 is d, plus xi minus 2 is d square. 1 plus d square is the first element. And the second element is 1 plus d square, delay of 2. Okay, 1 plus d square. So you can see that this generator matrix captures essentially these equations. Okay, so this is the generator matrix of this convolutional code. Equivalent generator matrix can be obtained if you multiply whole thing by 1 plus d. And keeping in mind that anything modulo 2 is 0. So when we multiply with 1 plus d here, so 1 plus d square plus d, so 2d is 0, plus d square, so 2d square is 0, plus d cube. So 1 plus d cube is left, okay, when we simplify. Similarly, we can find out the other ones. Right, so this is how we compute the, equivalent matrices. Similarly, for a, two input, four output convolutional code. G2 is this generator matrix. Equivalent generator matrix, you can obtain either this, this, or this. Okay, all are equivalent. So we can obtain the equivalent matrix by multiplying a non-zero element in the rows of the generator matrix. Now let me show you how to do the encoding. So suppose we want to encode 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. So in terms of polynomial, this is x is equal to 1 plus d plus 0 into d square plus 1 into d cube plus 0 into d raised to power 4 plus 1 into d raised to power 5. So essentially we are getting 1 plus d cube plus d raised to power 5. So 1 enters at 0, 1, 3, 5 time and 0 at 2 and 4 time. Okay. So generator matrix, remember, is 1 plus d square and 1 plus d square. So x times g1 will be c1, c2. So c1, the first output is 1 plus d cube plus d raised to power 5, our x, into the first entry in the generator matrix, which is 1 plus d plus d square. If you multiply and simplify, keeping everything modulo 2, we get 1 plus d raised to power 4 plus d raised to power 6 plus d raised to power 7. So essentially, c1 is nothing but this bit, 1 0 0 0 1 0 1 1. Similarly, we can find out the c2. C2 is 1 plus d cube plus d raised for 5 times 1 plus d square. Simplification will give us 1 plus d square plus d raised for 7. So c2 is 1 1 1 0 0 0 0 1. Okay, and so output is interleaved of these c1 and c2. It is 1 1 0 1 0 1 0 0 1 0 0 0 1 0 1 1. So interleaved of these two. 1 1 0 0 1 0 1, like that. Okay, 0 0, interleaving the two c1 and c2. This is the output. So this is how we do the encoding. So essentially, this picture here, how do we encode? We can compute it with the generator matrix as well, or we can use these two equations. So let me do this example in a little bit more details, and I will show you how encoding can be represented by a state diagram. Okay, so here is our picture, and we want to represent it as a state diagram. So how do we do this? So starting with encoding 1 1 0 1 0 1, So you see, this is the register before cycle. So initial content, so initial input is 1 here, and the content of the register is 00. Here xi minus 1 is 0 and xi minus 2 is 0 initially. Okay, initial content is 00 and entering is 1. 1 is entering here. Okay, so 1 is entering here. So then in that case, if initial content is 00, I can compute from these two equations what is c1i will be. Xi is 1, xi minus 1 is 0, xi minus 2 is 0, so 1 plus 0 plus 0 is 1. So c1i is 1 here. Okay, similarly, we can look at the second one, c2i. So c2i will be xi plus xi minus 2, xi is 1, xi minus 2 is 0, so 1 plus 0 is 1, so it is 1 1, right? So when input entry is 1, the first one, so the initial content of the register is 00, output is 11. We move to next input, which is 1 again, 1. So this one is pushed inside. So we are basically, the content is now 110. The register before cycle is 10. Output will be 01. We can compute it from this equations. Right. So like this, when 110101. So from here, input will be consumed. 1 1, so 3 or 3 6 bits are there. 110101, right? So 6 bits input is consumed, and we see that the state content is 01 only. So what we do, we pad with zeros until then we get 00 in the state content. 00, the register content should be 00 back, starting from 00, and we can keep on encoding. And then we start padding with zeros. The input is more, we can pad with more zeros until I get 00 in the state content, right? So the output will be this. Now, so this is our table showing the encoding of 110101 using these equations. Now, once these equations are done, now you note that what is changing here, the state of the register is 00101101100110100. Everything appearing twice, right? So basically, these are the states. I can make these as a state diagram, like, so 00 is one state, 01 is another one, 10 is another one, 11 is another one, right? And then I, depending upon each input, if input is 1, okay, for example, here input is 1, we put a dashed line here. So input is 1 here, input is 1 here, so we denote it by a dashed line here, okay? And output is whatever is the value of C1, C2, which is 1, 1 here. You can see that. We were in the state 0, 0 initially. Input is 1. So we move to state 1, 0. Okay. And dashed line is there because the input is 1. Okay. Next, input is again 1. So from 1, 0, state changes to 1, 1. And output is 0, 1. The next bit here, 0, 1. Output is 0, 1. Then again from 1, 1, input is 0. Okay, so there is a solid line here, solid line, and output is 01. Okay, like this we can compute the whole thing. So all this this table can be converted into a state diagram where there is a state changing from 00 to 01 to 10 to 11, and also if the input is 1, there is a dashed line. If input is 0, there is a solid line. Okay, if you are in 00, if you receive 0, you again come back to 00. So like that. So this whole calculation can be converted into a state diagram, right? So this is known as a state diagram of the encoding. So this encoding of this shift register sequences, from any shift register sequences, I can find out the state diagram of the system. Okay, so now once we have the state diagram, now this state diagram is at a given cycle. So suppose it is a cycle I, and if the next cycle is I plus 1, the state diagram, I can write it down again, it will change, right? So essentially, from this state diagram, I can get cycle I minus 1, suppose this, cycle I is this. So I can denote it by, state diagram is fixed, and I can make these arrows, so 0, 0, 1 or dashed line and so on, we can compute everything, right? So this is how we can actually make a what is known as Tailey's diagram. Actually, this is part of Tailey's diagram. I can all cycles I can write it down like this. So states are 0 0 0 1 1 0 1 1, and you know these are the diagrams. So 0 0 input is 1, so there is a dashed line, okay, and the output is 1 1, and you move to state 1 0, right? Everything is captured here in this form of diagram known as Tailey's diagram, you know. So for example, if you look at encoding is 1 0 1 1, so encoding will be A0. So A0, you go to C1, which is this. Then you go to B2, which is this. Then you go to C3, which is this. Then you go to D4, which is this. Then you go to B5, which is this. Then you go to A6, and which is this. So essentially, 1011 can be encoded like this. Okay. All this, all these edges I am reading here. So 1 1 is the first one. Then you know, like that, 1 0 is the second one from on this line, you know, and then 0 0 is the third one, then 0 1 is the fourth one, 0 1 is the fifth one, and 1 1 is the last one. So this is how we encode. The encoding can be done by looking at this Tailey's diagram, you know, starting from the 0 0 state, keep on moving after receiving 1 or 0. Suppose at 0 0 at A0, I have received 0, so then I will move along this line. Okay, if I received 1, I will move along this line. If I receive 0, I will have moved along this line, and the output will be 0 0 in that case. So this is the Tailey's diagram which captures the encoding. Okay, so any question at this point?
Sir, I would again like to see how that 12-digit output came.
Okay. So look at this. So from here, you know, we are at A00, right? A00, right?
Yes.
So input is 1, right? So input is 1. So basically, what will happen? Input is 1, so basically we will move to from here. Dashed line is there, remember? Dashed line.
Nine.
And output will be 1 1, right? 1 1 is output.
Okay. Oh, so that 12 is, means I have to look to output.
Yeah, output on the edge, which is 1 1, right?
Okay, okay.
And then go to the next one. Next one is 0. So we go to the solid line, and output is 1 0. 1 0 is here. You see?
Yes, sir. I got it.
Got it. And finally, because the input is 4 and still we are not reached to the 0 0, we have to pad with zeros. So after that, we assume 2 more zeros here to reach up to this stage, right? From
yeah.
Here to here. We are assuming that 2 zeros are there. We are padding with zeros. Got it?
Yes, sir. Got it.
Yeah. So this is the Tailey's diagram for encoding. So basically, from any finite state, so for any actually, for any this kind of register machine, shift register machine, I can convert it into I can get these equations, and from these equations I can actually write down this table. Once I make the table, I can make this state diagram, and once I make the state diagram, I can make this Tailey's diagram, right? So Tailey's diagram and encoding is done. Now let me show you how the decoding is done, how the Viterbi decoding is done. You know, it's a really nice concept. So what we do here, so suppose, so what we look at, we look at a L truncated Tailey's, which starts at I is equal to 0 and ends at L plus M. L is the length here. So I'm L truncated means a 6 truncated Tailey's diagram I am looking at. And M is the total memory size. Here memory size is 2, because you see the memory size is 2. Shift register has 2 memory, right? 0, 0 here, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. There are 2 of them. So capital M is 2 here. So L plus M is 8. So we'll stop at 8. Okay. So this is our Tailey's diagram. And suppose we received a vector y. So x is transmitted. Fine. Some x encoded version is transmitted. And y is received. So suppose y is received as 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. Y is received, right? So what I will do, I will write it down y on the top of the Tailey's diagram. And then I compute the distance. What is the distance from 1 1 to 0 0? It is 2, right? This block wise. This distance from 1, 1 and 0, 0 is 2. This distance from 0, 1 and 0, 0 is 1. Distance from 1, 1 and 1, 1 is 0. Right. So like this, you know, block wise, I can compute the distance from everyone. Right. So here is a computed distance one. Now you can see that distance, I have written the distance on the trellis diagram. 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1 from the received vector. Y is received. We have put Y on the top of the trellis diagram and compute the distance blockwise. Right. So I have computed all the distances here. So this is the trellis diagram with distances, weights in the trellis diagram. Now, what I do, I have to decode the vector. Right. Y is received. I put it on the top. I computed the distance. Now I will use the minimum distance decoding principle, similar to that, that I would look at minimum weight path. So I start from A00, which is this. Okay. And then I move. Okay. What is the first path? You know. So I can move from A00. I can either go into this direction. So weight will be 2, or I can go into this direction. Weight will be 0. So I'm going to choose the minimum one. Okay. This is the minimum one. 0 is the minimum one. So I will choose this one. So I'll arrive at C1. Okay. This is C1. I is equal to C1. So A0 I have written, then C1 I have arrived at. From C1, there are two possibilities. Either I can go into this direction. Right. I can go into this direction, or I can go into this direction. So I will choose this direction because the weight is minimal, 0. Right. From here. Now here there are two possibilities. One weight here, one weight here. So I can parallelly do the computation. You will see that one will give you more weights. So here we choose this one. Okay. And I'm ignoring the other one. You know, you can keep on doing that one. So from here to here, we'll have weight 1. Okay. And then weight 0, weight 1, weight 0, weight 0, and weight 0. So essentially, I will get A0, C1, D2, D3, B4, C5, D6, B7, A8. This is the path. Here, 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 here. Right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So total weight is what? One weight is here and one weight is here. So two weight. This is a path of weight 2. So the other path that we have not taken will be have weight more than 2 actually. So we can simply ignore that. So starting from the starting diagram, I started moving in the trellis diagram and try to find out the minimum weight path. And so this is the minimum weight path. Once we found the minimum weight path, I know what is there on the edge. I can write down those edge values, which is this. And from there, then we can compute the message, you know. So code word we have decoded actually. So X is, Y is received. From Y, we computed X here, right? And from X, we can compute the message, actually. So this is how we do the decoding. Any question at this point?
We have to consider the minimum weight path or...
Minimum weight path, yes. Minimum weight path.
For example, if there were starting from A00, we took 0.
Yeah, and because here the weight is 2, so we take the smallest one, which is weight 0, right?
But this is greedy selection. What if there were no weight after 2 and there were 3 weight after 0, then also we would pick 0 or we would pick
basically 0. So somehow we have to crawl the trellis. And such that we keep the minimum weight thing, of course, you are right. You have to choose the greedy approach. You have to keep the minimum weight aside, you know, minimum path. So, for example, here here we are getting two paths of weight 1, right? Which one to take? So, that can have another computation path, you know. So, you will see that later on that will lead to more weight. So, somehow we have to find the minimum weight path in this trellis diagram, okay? And that will give us the decoding. Got it?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So this is how the decoding is done. This is known as Viterbi decoding. Of course, you can write down the computer programs for doing all these things, you know, right? Viterbi decoding become quite popular. It was involved in many, many standards, actually, you know, it was used. And Qualcomm was founded because of Viterbi decoding, actually, you know, and later on, you know, it has involved into many other projects. But yeah, that was the key thing, key concept, you know, very simple decoding for convolutional codes. Okay, so I think that's that's all for convolutional codes today. I think, and we, I explained to you how encoding is done, how decoding is done. So essentially, a convolutional code is a k-dimensional subspace of f2d raised to power n. This is something we need to keep in mind. And f2d is a field, infinite field. It has infinite number of elements. Okay. And cardinal T of C is also infinite. Because f2d is infinite, so this is also infinite. So this is a basically basic idea about convolutional codes. I think that's all for today's lecture. So next class, I'm going to cover the DNA codes. And I think that's all. You know, we'll finish with the syllabus. Any other questions you have regarding codes or anything?
Sir, why F2D is infinite?
Because you see, there are infinitely many polynomials here, right? In F2D itself, is there are infinitely many polynomials. You compare it with set of integers. Set of integers are infinite, right?
Yes.
So similarly, here set of all polynomials in variable D. So there are infinitely many, right?
Yes, sir.
And then from set of integers, we build set of rational numbers, right? Q, P by Q.
Yes.
Same way we build F2D, PD by QD. Right. Same analogy.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that's infinite. Q is also infinite. Right. So F2D is also infinite.
Okay, sir. Got it.
Got it. So that's all. So anything, so about the course, everything is going fine. I mean, are you able to submit the, you know, that, what we call the project and everything is going fine?
Yes, sir. I have submitted the scribe notes.
Okay, good. The scribe notes you have submitted, and the project also. Are you doing project also, or you want to give the exam only?
I am currently looking at the project. If I will be able to do it, quite fine, then otherwise I will give exam also.
Okay, no problem. Fine. Good, no problem. Yeah, so exam this time is only for 1 hour actually. Okay. And okay. I think I will keep it very simple, so you don't have to do too much calculations. I hope it will be easy. Right. So I think we are almost ending. So one lecture is there on DNA codes. We will finish up the DNA codes, and then I think we are done with them more or less. So we have covered 3 applications and the basic content. So the convolutional code is ultimate thing. After that, of course, some people cover LDPC codes, but I think that is sometime done in the advanced courses. So, you know, if somebody is doing more advanced courses in coding theory, then they can do those things, because that itself is a whole lot of topics in the LDPC codes, low density petty check codes, you know. But I think the basic course is completed, you know, up to convolutional code is the basic, and the applications. So we talked about 2 applications. I think quantum video also you might have seen, you know. And so next class we'll talk about DNA codes. So that is also a very important thing. And that's all. And I think so we are going to cover, ask in the exam also up to the DNA codes, you know, on Wednesday. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.